reach using cell phone, call and text, we are preparing a different learning package for them. For those students with internet, we are sending another learning package for them. Meaning to say, it's possible that for a certain class, not all of them can be served through online or through internet. Some of them depends maybe on even very minimal, don't have cell phone even. So in that case, we need to send, the faculty should be able to reach them even and send hard copies. Now, on an institutional basis, that's what we are now looking at. If the university is ready, let's say we have learning management system, let's say we have good internet connection, let's say our faculty is trained, how about our students? We may consider, let's say, providing them a laptop through loans, but how can we get it? Now, it's a challenge among us administrators or presidents of SUCs on how we can provide these students with these gadgets, or let's say the least is tablets, because not all of them even have cell phones which let's say, for example, 3G or 4G. So not all of them have those cell phones. Even many of them have cell phones, but with low capacity, which cannot be used in the transmission of big bandwidth lectures. So these things are really in our pipeline to do or to address. So that's why, Mr. Chair, there are many things to look into, not only university. Now, the big challenge is for those university, which majority of our SUCs don't have sufficient ICT infrastructure. Some of us don't have serving telecommunication networks. So the challenge is connectivity. So there's a lot of challenge now. And this second semester is a good, I think, preparation for us to really strategize on how we can meet, even in the next semester. Mr. Chair, as we transition to this new normal, I could see even 1 year or 2 years is not enough for us really to be prepared.
Okay. Mr. Chair, Dr. Ronquillo, thank you very much for that explanation. So meaning, whether you are online or flexible, it is the same module, the same lesson plan.
Mr. Chair, our main thing that should be met is the intended learning outcomes. We have intended learning outcomes per subject or per course, or it's per subject. For this subject, what is the intended learning outcome? So now the challenge is on the teacher, on how he can devise different learning packages which will be able to meet these specific learning outcomes per course or per subject. So it's on the subject, or it's in the learning outcomes.
Yeah. So you might come up with different modalities depending on the current status of students as to whether they can do it or not. So you might be using internet if somebody is really equipped with the facility, but if not, you can have a modular type of learning opportunity for these children by, let's say, giving them a take-home exam with the same intended result for both students, with varying approaches or modalities to be used when you train them.
Mr. Chair, if I may add, our department chair of every program, there is a department chairperson. In our plan, the teacher should send the so-called flexible or alternative teaching and learning engagement plan. There is a plan, because there is a tendency, of course, for some teachers to overload students with so many things, with so many stuff to do, because they are at home. So we have ways to calibrate it. In our policy or guidelines, approved by our academic council, we calibrated, we specifically indicated there that for each course, during the continuation of this second semester, there should be only one final requirement. And the faculty member should assist to the fullest extent possible our students for them to be able to meet the requirement for them to pass the subject. So now, there is, as I have mentioned, there should be a mechanism in the department, between and among the faculty member, the students, and the department chairperson to check on this. So depending on the media and the learning packages and the module and that are available between the students and the faculty members, Mr. Chair.
Okay. Can we ask the other congressmen to ask the questions? If that will be okay with Congressman Swansing. Can we ask now Congressman Vic Yap of Tarlac to ask the next question? Kong Vic, yes.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, Chairman Go. Thank you for hosting this very good discussion and working towards the new norm. Secretary Popoy de Vera, Secretary Testa, Secretary La Peña, are they still available?
Yes, yes. Okay. We have Secretary La Peña is here, Chair Popoy de Vera.
Okay, let me dissect more or less into three categories. The basic education, or rather the higher education for government, which will be the 35% cut. I think Chairman Go and the members of this committee would have to do a lot of lobbying together with the secretary, good secretary De Vera, about maybe cutting down to 5 or 10% or maximum 15%. But with regards to the private sector, which has also a problem, the COCOPEA presented six areas. Being a member also of the economic affairs team working out the stimulus bill, may I suggest it's a good opportunity, no? One question, is COCOPEA the larger umbrella or group of private sector? Is it COCOPEA that is the one that's the larger umbrella for all of the LCU, the other associations?
May I respond, Mr. Chair? Congressman Yap, the Coordinating Council of Private Educational Associations is the umbrella organization for all private education institutions from basic education up to higher education. Only private, po. We do not have members.
Yes, I understand. So that's good that you're going to be presenting to the IATF, which will be more or less also crafting what they want to implement in the stimulus bill. One, you as a business enterprise can avail of loans, low interest rate loans. Kaya lang, more or less geared dito sa yan. I think that you will qualify, as mentioned by Congresswoman Swansing, low interest loans. Pero, syempre, ano pa rin yan, depende pa rin sa banko. So, maybe you can ask the IATF and Secretary of Finance na kung paano kayo maging madali yung loan sa inyo. Diba? Kasi it depends also on your going concern. Two, yung inyong gustong application for CAMP at sa DOLE, while the government, as mentioned by the president himself, is considering the middle class, I don't see any reason hindi kayo dapat masama rito. Ngunit, ang tingin ko, yung small and medium enterprises ang tina-target nito. So I guess, I suppose, ang mas vulnerable as you presented are the groups of smaller and medium scale institutions. Is that correct?
Sir, if I may respond. Actually, we still have, we have yet to hear a school, even the small schools, who have been beneficiaries of the financial assistance under CAMP. until it was transferred to the DOF under the small business wage subsidy. I think the faculty and the teachers and school personnel were not eligible to
in that case assistance. Yeah, in that case pasama kayo doon sa subsidy, salary subsidy, the 51 billion. You mentioned about 21 billion, but that includes the large institutions. So kung siguro ma-whittle down yan, I think they want to cover 2 months for 75% of the salaries. Maybe you could present an amount, maybe 5 billion, to include doon sa stimulus ng salary subsidy for your industry, specific industry of education of the private sector. Kasi yung government side, walang problema sa mga salaries, eh, no? Continued sila.
So sir, yeah, sorry po. Sir, may specific request lang po kami dun sa, sorry Mr. Chair for going ahead po. Yeah, the Congressman Yap, siguro po yung first po namin request dung, to include the education sector in the list of industries eligible to avail for their...
No, Congressman Swensing already did that. And I'll also follow up, Chairman Go will also follow up with the Chairman Sharon Garin. I think she's cooking right now, but we're going to text him afterwards. No?
Thank you po.
Lobby. But I think okay. You have to present to DOF immediately kung ilan. Kasi baka yung mga katulad ng Ateneo, Lasal, baka hindi na isali ano, yung malalaking eskwelahan.
I think po yung mga affected workers, those who no longer receive pay and those whose compensation have been substantially reduced, I think they, regardless of the, they're no longer looking at the size of the schools unless they are large taxpayers po, disqualified.
That's, I think you'll see how your discussions along with your presentation at the IATF will go. Now, good luck on that.
Thank you.
And then I'm all for the flexible type of migration, whether there is COVID or not. I think nakapag prepare na rin kayo on the note that kung makakakuha kayo ng mura-mura o subsidized na ano, that is one thing that you can probably ask for a quarter doon din sa inyong presentation sa IATF. Kung malalagyan nyo ng amount ito, baka makonsider, no? Pero until ko, I think ang pinaka-critical would be yung discussion ni Chairman De Vera with the DICT Secretary that supposed to be, dapat lahat ng mga higher education, since mas accessible yung inyong mga lugar kasi nasa central populations kayo all over the country, nandun kayo sa mga syudad, nandun kayo sa mga capital towns, dapat as of now, meron na kayong ability or may ability ang Globat Smart mag-wire in ng fiber sa inyo. As you pointed out, ang mas malaking problema is yung mga estudyante. But I'm all for flexible kasi yung mag-hold ka talaga ng online online teaching, magastos yun. I mean, yung broadband, mas matakaw. Whereas yung bibigyan mo ng instructions yung mga bata, ida-download niya, aaralin niya, merong link, aaralin niya. I think even with low internet speeds, achievable to in many areas. No? But as you said, you can blend it depending on the institution and where they're located. But I think it's about time. Part of the stimulus bill commands that the DICT should make available a government broadband plan in action. And I think ito yung kinakailangan, lalong-lalo na sa public sector, na kung saan maraming pwede magamit. And that government broadband plan is, strictly speaking, very feasible on the part, Chairman Go. Even for basic education, magagamit yan. And yung third point ko would be with TESDA.
Yes, Your Honor.
Secretary La Peña, good afternoon po.
Good afternoon po, Your Honor.
I recently, kasi wala rin tayo, marami rin tayong libreng oras. I recently applied with an online learning in a higher education in the US. Dali, nakapasok ako, libre. And it's great. You don't really have to be teaching real time. Ang ginagawa nila, and I think ginagawa natin rin ito ng mga ibang private institutions, especially with the elective courses, I think pwedeng mangyari ito na maging tool and access ng karamihan ng mga kababayan natin. Especially that the biggest question I have is, what is the projected unemployment of COVID in the near future, after post-COVID? I think that will run into millions. Marami rin mga kababayan natin babalik. And your menu of goes to into agriculture and everything. And I think formatting a platform wherein people can just access your online learning for free will be an efficient tool and cheap, no? And I think the private schools as well as the SUCs have the capability, have the people that can really or already doing it to assist the TESDA and come up with these menus of online learning. Tapos siguro kung nagawa niya talaga yung online learning niya, edi yung certification niya will come, just like in where I enrolled, will come with the test, or it can be in a person-to-person basis na papakita niya talaga yung skill niya at saka some test. And then that will be more efficient, Secretary. What do you think?
Yes, Your Honor, I fully agree. In fact, we do have a TESDA online program already. And this has been with us since 2012. But when the ECQ, the enhanced community quarantine was effected, we had this expanded. And we have now 68 courses, Your Honor. And we have a total since March 15, we have a total of 260 registrants already, Your Honor. And with a total of 60,000 that has completed their courses. And we continue to expand, Your Honor, because while this is one way of addressing yung lungkot na mga kababayan natin who are in staying sa mga kabahayan nila. At we prioritize yung mga courses that are applicable sa mga sa bahay para yung pagkagaya ng pagluluto, cookery, paggawa ng mga pagkain, mga and the like, as well as other courses, Your Honor. In fact, one of the enrollees recently is yung ating beauty, yung Miss Philippines natin, yung si Vicky Roston, and had three courses already, Your Honor. At nakita lang niya ito. And lalong dumami, Your Honor, yung mga nag-i-enroll sa ating test.
This is free, no?
Yes, yes, Your Honor.
And including a certification of the online course.
Yes, Your Honor, it is a certificate of completion, Your Honor. And then they can make use of this, yung certificate of completion, on the way to a national certificate after an assessment, Your Honor. So they can use this pag mag-assess. If they are confident enough na makaya na nila na mag-assess, then if they pass, then they will be issued a national certificate, Your Honor.
Are you having any budgetary problem or requirements or incapacity or lack of capacity to mold out and market this online program nationwide?
Not much problem, Your Honor, because we have started this 2012 and we expanded this. And then we had a problem when we had a surge of this registrant, Your Honor, nag-slow down. Sometimes hindi na nag-accept. So we requested the ICT to help us, and then they provided us additional capacity, Your Honor. So now, medyo malaki-laki na yung capacity namin, Your Honor. We are receiving an average of 4,000 daily, Your Honor, registrants.
That is very good to hear, Secretary Lopeña. I would advise that you would really set up a team, not really depending maybe after 6 months or 1 year with the ICT. you will really have to ramp it up, the platform. Talagang mag-i-investing kayo ng millions yan. I think this will be very, very beneficial, especially this period of unemployment and transfer or cross-employment that will happen in the coming months. Because hindi naman natin pwede talagang i-sustain lahat ng employment secretary kung talagang yung sitwasyon hindi kakayanin. As mentioned by Secretary Dominguez, hindi naman natin pwedeng talagang i-perpetuate kung talagang hindi na kaya ng negosyo, di ba? Some people, some businesses will have to succumb and look for other things. So that's why I think this is very important na makatulong. And if you can help us, Mr. Secretary, talagang yung National Broadband Plan,
yes.
Eh, noong 2019, walang pondo yon. In the interpolations, in 2018 budget presentation, nilagyan ng 2.5 billion yung National Broadband Plan. Para matapos, they need about 20 billion. But yes, for one year, ang libre na ma-access nating paggamit noon, direct, is about mga 9 to 8 billion. For 25 years, libre yan. So the government really stands to win pushing for that broadband plan. I hope together, since medyo hindi naman malayo yung taon nyo ni ano, di ba, sa PMA, Secretary Honasan.
Yes, Your Honor.
I think he will really see the benefit, not only in education, but also with the informal education such as TESDA. Thank you.
Yes, Your Honor. In fact, Secretary Honasan was very helpful with the TESDA when we need the help that of our internet will be increased to accommodate more registrants, Your Honor.
Thank you.
Chairman Goh, thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Kong Vic and Secretary La Peña. Our next interpellator is Congressman Joette Garcia. After him is Congressman Jun Babasa. Then we have Ms. Patricia Dalmas. And after Ms. Patricia, we'll have Congresswoman Franz Castro. Can we have now Congressman Joette Garcia of Bataan? Congressman Garcia? Are you there? Okay, while waiting for him, let's go to Congressman Jun Babasa. Congressman Jun?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Good evening po sa lahat. Good evening sa mga resource person natin. May question lang ako, Mr. Chair. I don't know if this was asked already before. Kanina kasi I was out for a while. Meron lang ba ako naging bisita. But ito kung gusto ko itanong kay Dr. Ronquillo, just a while ago, may dalawa tayong modality na sinasabi niya pwedeng i-implement sa mga SUCs during the opening this coming September. One is online learning, the other one is flexible learning.
Thank you.
Since hindi naman pare-pareho yung sitwasyon natin for every cities and municipalities, like sa Metro Manila, possible pong online learning, but in the cities, other cities as well as in the municipalities, I'm sure hindi po siya feasible. Put the time sa flexible learning. Since dito sa bayan namin, especially dito sa distrito namin, I'm sure, tanong ko lang kay Dr. Ronquillo, pwede bang mag-device yung local BOT o Board of Trustees ng isang state college, how to go about the learning process? Kasi hindi naman pare-pareho yung sitwasyon natin. Kagaya dito sa amin, I'm sure, classroom pa rin ang pinaka-feasible. Of course, i-observe natin yung protocols as during dito sa GCQ environment, which is part of that is the social distancing. But tanong ko lang, pwede bang mag-combination kami dito, gawa kami ng plano at kailangan pa bang ipa-approve to sa CHED? Kasi hindi naman pare-pareho yung sitwasyon natin dito sa pagdating sa mga lugar. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Chair Popoy Dubera, can you answer the question, please?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think the sequence of things that must be done now is very important. What is important for universities is to do several things. Number one, do an inventory of their connectivity and strength in the whole country. That's why we are talking with the ICT, and next week, the ICT will hold a Zoom session with the university presidents and give them a system to check bandwidth, broadband strength in their different campuses. We need that. Without that data, para tayong sumusuntok sa buwan, because we're working on a lot of assumptions with no data. Universities must also do an inventory of their students and their faculty. Classify the students who have no connectivity at all, classify the students that have a cell phone but limited connectivity, and classify the students that have full connectivity. Classify their teachers in terms of ability to use technology in their instruction. Those who have very weak, those who cannot even make a PowerPoint presentation and can only use the classroom. Now, this data that you generate if you're a university becomes the basis to now design how your flexible learning should look like. So the design should be flexible so that students who have no access to technology, have no cell phone, must be treated differently versus those who already have capability. So the challenge for a faculty member, if you start designing your course must design and adjust to the profile of the students that you have, and also be based on your capability as a faculty member to deliver flexible modes. So yung curriculum mo, merong portions doon na naka-adjust doon sa kayang online, naka-adjust din doon sa purely residential. I think that is the key. But without that data, it will be very difficult to design anything. And I think what the universities are doing now is start getting that data. There are universities when they reported to CHED that have already classified their students. Sino yung walang cellphone at all, nakatira, walang connectivity? Sino may cellphone pero naglo-load lang? Sino yung may cellphone tsaka may internet sa bahay? And therefore, you have to navigate around this data or this information when you design it. Flexible learning does not mean that you will have no classroom instruction anymore. But it also does not mean that you will only have classroom instruction. It should be a mix of delivery modes depending on the data that you have. So yung mga estudyante na may connectivity, kayang mag-internet, pwedeng hindi na papasokin regularly yan. Pwedeng papasok once a week, every other week, modular yung kanyang pag-aaral, nagko-consult sa student. Pero we have to accept that there will be students who may have no connectivity, have no capability to the internet. Then we will treat them in a residential mode. So I think the universities must first get that data before they start planning. And some universities are better equipped than others, because some universities have very good IT infrastructure. So mas madali sila. Yung universities mahinang infrastructure, they'll have to decide how to increase their bandwidth. Minsan yung signal nandoon naman sa locality, baka ang intervention ay palalakasin mo yung signal na nasa campus. So these are things that the universities have to do in the next 3 months. I think the difficulty is you have to do all of this simultaneously. Kasi kung if we have the luxury of time, we have 1 year to prepare, mas madali. Ang challenge talaga is pagsasabay-sabayin mo ito habang gumagawa ka ng bagong syllabus, nag-iimbentaryo ka din ng estudyante mo, and that may be difficult for some universities. I think that is the reality that we are faced now. Now, what is the proper approach? It will be defined by how universities help each other. Ang gagawin ng CHED, we will get the good universities that are already doing flexible learning to talk to and help the universities that are not yet good on flexible learning. For example, yung Mapua will do a Zoom session with university presidents next week. Sasabihin sa kanila, how did we set up our learning management system? Paano ba namin sinet up? Paano kinustomize? Anong information ang nilagay? Paano tinuruan yung mga faculty member? We are also putting in place training programs of universities that are already doing a good job. There are many private universities that can already train teachers on the use of technology. Ang commitment ng CHED, babayaran namin yung training program ng mga faculty. Pero again, depende sa faculty yan. Kasi ang faculty mo, na hindi marunong gumawa ng PowerPoint, eh ang unang training niya, how do you use technology in designing your classes? Pero may mga faculty na marunong ng technology. Ang challenge, how do you make the online resources available? E-books, you know, modules that are available online. How do you connect that with the faculty members so they can use that when they do the classroom? So I think this is the direction that we have to pursue. I think, as I said, the challenge is we have to do all of it simultaneously.
Thank you, Chairman Popoy. Can we do we have another question, Kong Jun?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Wala na po. Thank you, Chairman Rivera. Thank you po sa other.
Thank you very much, Kong Jun. Now we would like to call on Ms. Patricia Dalmas of the TechBok Association of the Philippines. Can we call Ms. Dalmas? Yes, please. Please unmute your.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Magandang hapon po sa inyo and greetings to Secretary Sid La Peña. Hello, sir.
Hello.
And to Chairperson Popoy Rivera and to all the guests and participants of this very, very quality discussion regarding our concern. To Secretary La Peña, I am very grateful, we are grateful in TVIs for your very comprehensive report as reported by Director Marisa regarding the details of what you're going to do and what you have been doing. Now, Sec, I have only one concern, which is really very important. We in the private sector would like to know how can the private sector be included, or how can we be of help or participate in the TESDA's new normal scheme? Considering that TVIs is about 95% to 97% of the schools. Now, number two is about in the report, of course, we understand the budgetary concern that it is talagang kulang at hindi enough. Now, can our department, can our agency, of course, through you, Sid, if you can be a bridge for us to other funding agencies to help our small businesses, because our concern here, sir, is the impact of this pandemic to small businesses, to our TVIs, the small ones. The impact is they're gonna be shutting down because they only have a month until May 14 to roll on their budget. So how can the agency, through of course you, sir, how can you be a bridge or mediate in looking for a budget? I'm very happy with Congressman Swan Singh and the other congressman from Tarlac regarding about the banks. But sure, it would need a bill. Now this one is a pressing concern. Pag nangyari po siya yan, mag-shutdown po ang mga TVRs. Ilan na lang po ang maiiwan. We will have around 21 billion loss. And it is has a great effect on our economy. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you. Can we ask Secretary La Peña to answer the question of Ms. Dalmas?
Yes, thank you, Your Honor. There are two questions. Number one is how can we help the TBIs on their operation, considering that decomposed 90% compared to the TTIs, Test the Technical Technology Institute. Yes, indeed. It will be just like before. The allocation will go to proportionately to TVIs and of course the TESDA Technology Institute. So pag pwede na yung mag-malit na yung suspension ng mga klase, then we can start immediately. In fact, we have been processing yung mga qualification map, yung mga allocation. And ang aking guidance diyan is yung mga scholarship programs will be equitably allocated to the TBIs. Of course, yung para sa TTI, then they will have their share. And then yung mga TBS naman, they will have their share. So it's just like before the pandemic, pag na-lift yung suspension ng mga klase, then we will just go back to how we do it before. Of course, with the new normal protocols, yan na yung mga wearing of masks, mga strict preventive protocol. And then ang isang problema diyan is the yung social distancing, dahil kasi ang ating mga eskwelahan ay designed to accommodate 25, but with the social distancing baka hindi pwede yung 25 doon sa mga rooms ng mga schools natin. So these are the things that we are going to study para we can adapt maximize yung mga training facilities natin. And then on the second is how can I help yung mga TBIs that need funding. Well, I will be willing to help in what legal capacity that I can do. At just like yung kung ano yung kailangan na endorsement, siguro endorsement ang aking magagawa diyan. And then of course ang pag-apply niya na will be with the banks, with the financial institutions. At yun yung may mga requirements yan. And then tayo naman gusto natin na yung mga TBIs natin will be there because they are a big help dito sa accomplish ng mandate ng TESDA. So you can be rest assured na when it comes to the well-being of our TBIs, the TESDA will be there to support them.
Thank you,
okay,
sir.
Thank you very much, Secretary La Peña. We will have now Congresswoman Franz Castro. Then after that will be Congresswoman Ruth Mariano Hernandez. Then we have Congressman Jau Jimenez and Congresswoman Alexis Chutor. Can we call now on Congresswoman Franz Castro? Yes. Are we gonna hear you? Yeah, I think there's something wrong with the audio. Hello. Yes. We cannot hear you, Congresswoman France. Okay, I think last hour.
Okay, IC. How about this? Can you?
Yeah. Okay. Please continue. You unmuted your.
Okay.
Okay. Can you... Yeah. Please. Oh. We cannot hear you. I think there's something wrong with the line, the audio.
Ayan po, Mr. Chair. Can you hear me now?
Yes, please.
Yeah. Kay Chief Popoy de Vera po, no, Mr. Chair. Maganda po yung sinasabi niya, no, tungkol sa iba't ibang modalities. And they are asking for the data now as regards to the students who have can access with the internet, students who have cell phone, students who have different concerns about the internet. So, tanong ko lang po, Mr. Chair, kailan kaya makukuha natin itong mga data na to doon sa ginagather nila? Or meron po bang memo to that effect para makita po natin talaga yung problem natin as regards to the internet connectivity of the students?
Yung sa internet connectivity ng campus, DICT will do a Zoom session with both public and private universities by next week. And then meron silang ibibigay na measuring system that the universities can use to test their broadband, the strength, etc. So we can start generating the data. The question on the profile of students, some universities have already done it. Some are doing it. We are looking now at the instrument they are using to standardize it across universities. Pero may mga university na ginawa na nila ito habang ECQ. Like Mariano Marcos State University in Lawag, sinurvey na nila lahat yung student habang nag-ECQ. In fact, alam nila kung sino yung mga estudyante nila ang galing sa Ilocos Norte, sino yung galing sa ibang bayan, para kung mag-flexible learning sila right after the lifting of the ECQ, alam nila kung sino ang pwedeng makapag-submit ng materials, yung mga pwedeng hindi makapasok sa probinsya kung may quarantine pa. So iba-iba yung level kasi may mga universities na they maximize the period of ECQ to do an inventory of their students. Like Visayas State University in Baybay, when they reported, they have 900 students coming from areas outside of Leyte. Kaya problematic sila kung magbubukas pa sila ng klase kasi paano makakapasok ng Leyte yung 900 students coming from the different areas in the Visayas and even Luzon. So ang decision nila, huwag nang mag-physical classes. Mag-submit na lang ng requirements. So when you say, when will the data be available? We're doing our best to fast track it. Some have, some don't have. So that is the current situation. When they reported to me, when we had regional, Zoom meetings, when they reported the status to the community.
Okay, that is good po, no? Your second concern ko, Mr. Chair, yung about dun sa mga contractual personnel po natin doon sa mga state colleges and universities. So, ano po ba ito? Tapos, dahil nagkaroon ng ECQ, ano po ba yung mga support na naibigay?
Can we unmute? Ang galing yan.
Ang galing yan. Hindi ko po alam saan nanggaling yun.
Okay, can we limit to two more questions, Congresswoman? Because we will finish before 7 o'clock. Okay, so can we ask the one who will answer?
Okay.
Anybody would like to answer for those you are referring to casual employees, temporary employees?
Yes, Mr. Chair. Yung mga casual employees po kasi yun sa ECQ ngayon, paano po natin sila nasuportahan?
yung casual tsaka mga contractuals and job orders, the individual universities will be guided by issuances of the DBM and COA. They issued one at the start of the ECQ. DBM issued another one lately. So it will be by state university, kasi iba-iba yung percentage nila ng casual, contractuals. So each of the universities now are looking into it. I just finished my board meeting with Visayas State University yesterday. Ang isang dinesisyon na namin sa board, anong gagawin sa mga job orders at contractuals. Kasi there is a DBM requirement that you cannot hire anymore, etc. No? And that some of the operations that you will have for the rest of the year, you will not continue anymore. Kasi may mga, yung mga hindi pa na-release na pera, i-discontinue na yung projects. So yung mga naka-attach na personnel doon, tatamaan ng discontinuance of project, the reduction of 35% and 10% for MOOE. All of this will have personnel implications because contractuals are connected usually with projects. So it will depend on a university by university basis because some of the universities, they pay it through their income, for example. So pag natanggap naman nila yung reimbursement ng tuition tsaka miscellaneous fees na galing sa CHED, they have capacity to pay the contractuals, the part-timers, etc. But there is no... I would not know what is the situation as a whole. It would depend on a university by university basis.
Okay. Thank you po. Chair, last na private school teachers ngayon na nawalan po sila ng trabaho or nawalan po sila ng or you know work no pay. Ito po bang mga small, medium, ano po ba ang differences nito in terms of enrollment po ba yan or number of teachers? Or ano po, paano po ba o capitalization? Kay Attorney Estrada po, Mr. Chair. And then, ano po kahilingan para doon sa hindi po sila nasakop ng camp, nung CA yung camp po, doon sa small business support?
Yung po mga small, medium, and large schools, according to ano po yon? According to enrollment, according to program offerings. Inano lang po namin doon sa based on sa aming survey. So, yung mga affected doon, Congresswoman Castro, based on the camp guidelines yung sa advisory ng DOLE, those who do not receive pay because of the suspension of the work, and those who are asked to report to work under flexible working conditions but they receive a reduction in their pay. So dapat po pasok sila. So sila po ay mga in-apply din ng mga respective schools nila, private schools and higher education institutions. But I think most, if not all, have been declined or denied. Yung iba po, di nirek sa DOF after the extension of the ECQ. But the DOF naman po, under the small business wage subsidy, sinabi rin po na hindi po kasama ang education sector. So so in short, yung pong ating mga school personnel have not been eligible to any government assistance as of this time po.
So magkano po yung amount na gusto natin na maibigay na lalo na ngayon sa ECQ?
Well, yung ano po, yung po kasi diba, like for example the stimulus package and yung mga nauna na po na social amelioration program, I think the range is from 5 to 8,000. Yeah, siguro hindi naman po yung exact na salaries nila, na actual salaries, but just include them in whatever social amelioration packages and yung mga economic stimulus package kung may sasama po sana sila. Like yung similar sa camp, yung camp po is 5,000. So we applied
okay,
also.
Hindi po sila kasama eh. Sige, support po kami dyan. Alam ko po ang ating chair ay supportive din sa ganyang cause. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you very much, Congresswoman Franz. Let's call on Congresswoman Ruth Hernandez. Congresswoman Ruth.
Good evening, Chairman.
Yes, good evening.
Good evening, Chairman Go, and good evening po to everyone, especially po kay Chairman De Vera and Secretary La Peña. My concern is addressed to Secretary La Peña, Chairman. Chairman?
Yes, Your Honor.
My concern is addressed to Secretary La Peña. Hello, Secretary. I know po that the ESDA has released the new regulations or new training regulations for barangay health workers, sir.
Yes, Your Honor.
Yes, and I know po na at this time we are in need for additional health workers in the barangays. Kaya po, Secretary, humihiling po ako, I'm appealing to your office that we ramp up ano po, yung mga free training courses for our barangay health workers to address po yung growing needs ng ating community or ng ating barangays for health workers para po makapacitate sila and ma-equip sila with knowledge para po sa mga barangay health services, Secretary.
Yes, Your Honor. In fact, that's the very purpose of that training for the barangay health workers. It happened that we need it now, so that becomes a priority. Once namalip itong suspension training, ang mga classes natin, we will go out training ng barangay health workers. Kasi itong ating situation na ito, we do not know kung hanggang kailan ito eh. That's why we need more barangay health workers, and you can be assured, Your Honor, that we will do this. I have given instruction already that this will be a priority program to be implemented, Your Honor. Sorry, Your Honor, I did not hear you. Walang sound.
Can you unmute your audio? Congresswoman Ruth, you have to unmute.
Yes, sir.
Go ahead.
Can you hear me now, Secretary La Peña?
I hear you now.
Secretary, sorry. Do you hear me now?
Yes. Yes, Your Honor.
Thank you, Secretary. So you mean, Secretary, the free training course for our barangay health workers will be held after the lifting of the quarantine?
Yes, Your Honor. Because of the quarantine, the training are... So, it is lifted, suspension, with lifting of the quarantine. Or when we reach a GCQ... yung suspension, Your Honor.
Secretary, will there be simultaneous training for the different barangays in our country?
Yes, Your Honor. Well, we have centers in our provincial
There's something wrong with the line.
To train barangay health centers in all the barangays, but of course we cannot accommodate them all at the same time, so we will have to schedule, Your Honor. But it will be continuing training, Your Honor. It will be continuing program for as long as it is needed, Your Honor.
So thank you very much, sir. Thank you. Mr. Chair, thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Congressman. Can we now call on Congressman Cesar Jau Jimenez? Kong Jau, you can now ask your question.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, my dear colleagues, and to our guests. Good evening, po. My concerns will have to do with realignment of funds. May we know, sir, if CHED can guide us, is there still a need, and do we still need an action from Congress so that funds may be realigned for the state use so that we can accommodate the purpose of the flexible learning options? Because obviously, for example, in Region 9, as stated by Kong Babasa earlier, we have a huge funding requirement that will be necessary even for internet services. Mr. Chairman, yeah. Can you guide us on the matter?
Yes, may I ask our Executive Director, Cindy Haro, to guide us? She's the one sitting down with DBM all the time. Kasi kami sa CHED, hirap na hirap din kami. May mga gusto kami i-realign, ayaw din ang DBM. So can Attorney Cindy answer the question? How much latitude do they have to realign funds within their budget so that they can address connectivity issues, they can pay for a learning management system, etc., that will allow them to be flexible? Si Edi Haro is the one sitting down with the Director Tess of DBM regularly.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon, Congressman Cesar. So to answer your question, sir, as to the realignment that will be needed by CHED, actually, sir, when we evaluated the funding of CHED, it seems that we will be able to give financial support naman. One, for the training of the faculty, and also for the training of the faculty for the production of OERs, yung open educational resources. But our hindi naman sir, para medyo issue lang po is with respect to the funding. Kasi per the DBM regulations, sir, or rules po, we cannot realign it in such a way na wala po siyang financial structure. There should be a PAP in which we will be able to realign the programs. One of the areas for our PAPs or yung program appropriations that we are eyeing po, that we can use for this related purpose is the K-12 funding po namin. But there is some apprehension since there is a provision po in the GAA that it says na it is for K-12 funding. So if you can help us, siguro sir, I don't know lang po kung paano, kung should it be through a law also, na we will be able to spend our K-12 funding for the in relation to the COVID-related projects and purposes of CHED, sir.
Yeah. In short, Mr. Chairman, CHED na ang bahala dun sa cost ng pag-train ng teachers. We can handle that. Now we have some funds that we can use to train the teachers for flexible learning. We have some flexibility with funds to develop the resources that can be put online that the teachers can use. Yung portion na yan, medyo kaya namin yan. Ang hindi malinaw pa, whether we could provide assistance, for example, to universities as they set up their learning management system. Parang hindi namin makita yung paano ina-navigate yan. I wish we could. Maybe what we could do is provide experts to the universities who will set up their learning management system. We can pay for that through a project. Yung dun sa individual SOOCs, I don't know how much flexibility of money they have within the SOOCs to do any significant realignment for connectivity or for learning management system. Kaya yung learning management system, siguro ang mangyayari, the SOOCs can start with a free system, no? Yung hindi proprietary. Set it up and then eventually migrate to a proprietary system as funds are available. Kasi kung mag-establish ka agad ng proprietary system, mag-procurement ka pa, etc., matagal eh. Samantalang yung free system that can be used already by universities. And CHED can help the universities set that up by providing technical assistance. So maybe Dr. Ronquillo, because he runs a university, would know whether there is significant money within your budget that you can realign for connectivity or for learning management system. Yan yung mga urgent na kailangang ayusin to do flexible learning. Pero yung iba, kaya nang sagutin ng CHED yung iba. meron na kami na identified na funding source, both for public and private universities.
Thank you. Do we have another question from Congressman Joe Jimenez?
Just one more point. Yes, Mr. Chairman. Mukhang kailangan pag-aralan natin sa committee natin on how to go about if there's a need for a law or kailangan na amend yung batas natin so that the funds may be aligned for the purpose. And just one quick question, sir. As announced by Secretary Roque, if I'm not mistaken, for cities and provinces that will no longer be under an extended ECQ, that they, pag nasa general quarantine sila. And it was stated that May 4, maaari lang.
Can you repeat your question? It seems you were cut. Congressman Jau, can you repeat your question?
Especially
the last part. Sir. It was announced by Secretary Roque.
As announced by Secretary Roque, for cities and provinces that will be under GCQ, May 4, I think, is stated that maaari nang magbukas yung mga eskwelahan natin. Is that according to you, sir, feasible na May 4 makaka-open yung mga eskwelahan natin? Under GCQ, of course.
Chairman Popoy, can you answer the question?
Yes, I was the one who submitted that resolution in the IATF. We need to allow the universities to continue the semester and provide a skeletal workforce so that they can, number one, close the semester. Because they have to have a skeletal workforce so that the submission of students of the requirements that that they have to submit to complete the semester, somebody has to receive it in the university, somebody has to compute the grades, and more important, start giving out the credentials like diplomas, transcript of records, because this cannot be done electronically. But it is not visualized that you will do residential classes after May 4. It is to close the semester, number one. Number two, complete the credentials. And number three, prepare for the opening of classes in August. So for example, you will have, you need a skeletal workforce kasi yung submission of grades, hindi naman purely electronic yan sa madaming universities. I sponsored that resolution because I found out on the ground na may mga local governments na kahit na nag-skeletal yung government agencies, ayaw nilang payagan yung skeletal sa mga universities. That's why I made the motion there na dapat the universities should be allowed to have a skeletal force, because otherwise they will not be able to close the semester. They will not, the students cannot graduate and they cannot prepare for the next semester. So that was the reason why it was included in the IATF recommendations approved by the president.
Thank you, Bob. So, Mr. Chair, I assume that all the state universities and colleges as well as higher educational institutions have already ended their second semester classes. And therefore, what they just need to do is to complete all the requirements of the students as well as submit the grades if that is the decision of the state university or the college.
No, some of them are extending the semester by 1 month. Some of them are extending the semester, but they will not have residential regular classes anymore. This will be for consultation, submission of requirements, etc. So merong isang nagplaplo, no, hindi ko alam kung itutuloy, but Batanes State University was initially planning, I don't know if they will push through with it, kasi sabi ng Batanes, walang COVID, Batanes is COVID-free from the start. Why will you now not allow us to continue some classes? But I don't know whether they're going to proceed. But when they first reported, they said in COVID-free provinces, we will discuss it with our local governments about the viability of continuing classes.
How many percent of the total SUCs and HCIs are going to continue classes? Would we know at this point in time?
It's very small.
Okay,
yes,
so
most of the SOOCs agreed that they will end classes in April 13. No more face-to-face, no residential. And then they will just provide days for the students to submit the requirements so their grades can be computed.
Okay.
I don't know with the private schools. Maybe Cocopeya would be in a better position to answer. Sa SOOCs kasi pinag-report namin lahat sila sa CHED. Sa private schools, hindi pa namin sila na pagre-report.
Kung Jau, do you have any other question? Do you have any other question? Okay, thank you very much, Chairman Popoy and Congressman Jau Jimenez. Now let's call on Congresswoman Alexis Chutor. Before you ask the question, I would like to recognize Congresswoman Sara Ilago of Kabataan Party List.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, naririnig niyo ba?
Yes, loud and clear.
Good evening po sa lahat. So, isa na lang po yung question ko kasi na sagot na ni Chairman Popoy kanina about the job orders ng mga SOCs. So, to Chairman Popoy po, Chairman, paano yung UNIFAS TES natin ngayon? What will be the status for this year, 2020?
Yung 2019 pa lang ang sinusubukan naming ibigay lahat yung pera kasi out of the 9 billion for tests for private universities, only 3.6 has been released to CHED. We requested this in December pa. So dumating na yung 3.6, we are now downloading it to the region. By next week, it should reach the private universities, or it should reach the beneficiaries already, students in private universities. We hope we could get a release for the whole 9 billion. And then we will start focusing on the 2020 test. Kasi yung 2020 test, magsisimula naman yan pag nag-apply na yung mga estudyante pagbukas ng klase. Hello? When the schools apply for their students, that will still happen around August or September. So the money is with us. Ang ginawa ng DBM, we need hold na yung tuition and reimbursement for SOOCs for their second semester. Kasi 2021 pa naman yan babayaran. So ang sabi ng DBM, ikalga na lang yan doon sa 2021 budget. The first things first, we have to get the test to the private schools out first. And we've been trying to do it for about 3 months now.
Okay, Chairman Popoy, so the timeline for yung completion for 2019, baka May, June, or July?
Yung 3.6 na binigay sa amin last week, ubus lahat yan by next week. We will use the whole amount by next week. We have already identified the beneficiaries based on the submission of private schools to PAYAC. So we will zero balance the 3.6 and then we will ask DBM for the remaining 6 billion pesos. I hope you can help us test DBM to release it so we can release the rest to the test in private universities. Kasama din yan, if I'm not mistaken, ED Halo, yung continuing tulong dunong, tama ba? Mababayaran na rin namin starting next week kasi binigay na yung pera sa amin.
Yes, sir, yung sa tulong dunong, sir, wala pa pong SARO. Ano lang po, test pa lang po. Test lang po ng listahan ng 2.0 and then the no SUC, no LUC, sir.
Wala pa pala yung continuing tulong dunong. Ang problema kasi dito, kami sinisisi ng mga bata na hindi lang nakukuha. Ang sabi ko, wala naman kaming perang ibibigay. So we keep on asking DBM to release. Once they release it to us, within a week, within 2 weeks, nakababa na yan sa mga estudyante for the qualified universities.
Yeah, Chairman, baka pwede nating tulungan si Chairman Popoy with the problem with the DBM?
Yeah, I think we will talk with the DBM together with our speaker and the committee chair on appropriation.
Thank you, Chairman. Yun lang po. Thank you, Chairman Popoy.
Okay. Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, Kong Alexis. Can we call on Kong Divine Yu? Congresswoman Divine Yu? Okay, I think we have another congresswoman who would like to ask. Congresswoman Sara Ilago. Yeah, please. That will be probably the last question.
Hi, good evening po. Maraming salamat, Chair. At tungkol lang po sa lahat ng mga naka-enroll pa currently, may mga nananawagan po ng partial refund para dun sa total na binayaran nila ng tuition and other school fees. Halimbawa po, yung mga supplies na, yung mga binayaran na supplies para sa mga laboratory na hindi naman ginamit for the duration na wala po silang klase o wala namang actual na lab classes, mayroon po bang guide ang CHED dito o a refund policy na magagabay po sa ating mga private higher education institutions?
Ang position po ng commission dyan ay yung pagbayad ng tuition is a transaction between a student and a private school. Siya po'y labas sa mandato ng commission. And different private schools are responding differently to this. May mga nag-soli na, may mga nagpla-planong mag-soli, may mga nagpla-planong i-defer. But this is really better left to the discussion between the students and the private universities.
Mr. Chair, sa pagkakaalam ko po, ang CHED ay may National Multisectoral Board for Tuition and Other School Fees. Baka po pwede niyong ma-convene ito maski online na para mapag-usapan yung possibility ng guide lang for refund policy. Para po, ang nangyari po kasi katulad ng sinabi ni Chair Popoy, depende sa schools yung action at hindi yun ibang mga schools din, laboratory fees kadalasan o yung mga fees na for libraries at yung mga hindi talaga nagamit ng school sa duration po na walang pasok doon sa kanilang mga campuses. So mainam na may general guide for refund policy ang CHED dito. Pangalawa, Chair, tungkol lang sa tuition and other fee increases for the next academic year. Papayagan po ba natin na magtaas pa ng tuition and other fees for the next academic year? O may nilabas na po ba tayong policy na wala po munang magtataas dahil tayo po ay nasa gitna ng krisis?
Wala ho sa mandato ng komisyon na sabihin hindi pwede magtaas ng fee. Ang papel ng komisyon is to ensure that the legal requirements and processes are followed. May mga nag-apply na ho ng first quarter of this year, but the application process is done in the regional offices of CHED. So I wouldn't know who applied, how much they applied for, and what is the status of their application. I think most of it were put on hold because of the quarantine. No? So I have not really studied what is happening with tuition fee applications, but usually, the process is observed at the region. So hindi pa ho na pag-uusapan ng commission ito at ang importante ho ay tignan kung yung proseso ay masusunod, no? Kasi we have to balance between the interest of the students and the viability of private universities because in the end, everybody loses, no? If the private universities are not able to generate income and they are being forced to move their opening much later, their financial viability is also affected. And if their financial viability gets worse, it's not just the private schools who suffer, it is the students because they don't have anywhere to go. That's why I am strongly supporting the support of government to the private universities. In the end, I am doing this because I want to safeguard the access of students to private education. That is the position I have taken in the IATF. I said, higher education is unique because majority of students are enrolled in private universities. So we have to look at the financial situation of private universities and make sure that there is space for students to continue enrolling. My fear actually is not the increase in tuition fees. My fear is that there will be a significant reduction in enrollment next semester. Kasi madaming nawalan ng trabaho, ang daming OFW ang umuwi. Ang daming mga nasa small businesses na nagbabayad ng tuition niya sa private schools on a monthly basis kasi hindi nila kaya yung malakihang bayad at the start of the SEM. I think we have to address this and flexible loans to students even only for this school year para meron man lang silang pantawid, makapag-enroll pa sila kung mahina man ang trabaho ng kanilang magulang, habang nagpi-financial subsidy, parang tinutulungan natin yung private schools, kailangan may direct ang tulong din sa mga estudyante para may pang-tuition siya sila sa next semester. One without the other wouldn't work eh. Kasi kung wala talagang pambayad yung estudyante, taasan man ng private school yung tuition fee, hindi rin makakapag-aral talaga yung estudyante. I know it's a very difficult balance to take out, but the commission wants to support both directions.
Yeah. Sa kabilang banda, Mr. Chair, pwede rin naman na malaking ginhawa po sa mga estudyante kung may ensure na walang magtataas and possibly po pwede pa pong pag-aralan. Hindi naman pareho yung ginagastos doon sa actual na nandyan yung mga estudyante sa campus, doon po sa mga ginagastos ng mga private universities kapag sila ay nagkaroon na ng flexible learning mode. Kaya po, mainam na maging bukas ang CHED sa ganyan po na pag-aaral. And last question, Mr. Chair, tungkol lang po sa flexible learning method, magkakaroon din po ba ng pagbabago doon sa grading system? No, kasi hindi naman po natin pwedeng i-expect na yung mga estudyante po ay makakapag-perform pa as if wala po tayo sa gitna ng crisis at parang nagpo-proceed po tayo sa normal kung walang magiging pagbabago sa grading system. Dahil marami din pong factors na beyond sa control ng estudyante pati po nung kinalalagyan ng kanilang mga pamilya sa panahon po ng crisis. So meron po bang magiging pagbabago o isang uniform guidance sa mga schools tungkol po sa grading system para ma-ensure na wala naman pong babagsak para sa mga dahilan na wala po sa control ng mga estudyante?
Halos lahat ng mga state universities and colleges na nag-report sa CHED have adopted a policy na for the second SEM walang babagsak. Most have already adopted the policy. And they have extended the completion of requirements for 1 year. So itong semestre, pag isasara nila, pagka kulang yung requirements, binibigyan na isang taon yung bata na kumpletohin yung requirements para magkaroon ng grade. Pero irrespective na matapos niya o ba-complete niya o hindi, ang kadamihan sa mga state universities, hindi babagsak ang sino mang estudyante for the second semester. I think that move is more than unprecedented because of the crisis. Doon sa dalawang state university ko na nag-board meeting the past 2 days, they have adopted that policy. Nobody will fail. I think that is that shows that universities have the best interest of their students in mind. Kasi wala nang babagsak, pati yung mga incomplete, in-extend ng isa pang taon. Yung mga incomplete na dapat magmamature the second SEM, in BSU, they extended it by another semester. I think everybody is really, you know, being as flexible as they can. So, ang ginagawa nung... Yes.
Ay, sorry po. Yes. Ibig sabihin, may no-fail o universal pass policy na po ngayon sa public?
Hindi, no-fail. No-fail ang kanilang... ang kanilang in-adapt. Kasi ang consensus sa university, kailangan pa din nila ng numeric grades. Yun ang consensus sa university. Pero yung no-fail, most universities have adopted that policy already.
Sige, hindi na lang po tayo ng report tungkol po doon sa no-fail policy, Chair. Maraming okay. Salamat po. At okay. Magbibigay na lang din po kami ng kopya sa mga members tungkol po sa binubuo po ng kabataan na Education Emergency Relief Fund para po sa student and faculty aid and institutional support na rin po sa public and private schools na apektado. Maraming salamat, Chair, po sa pagkakataon.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much, Congresswoman Sara. I think Attorney Erap Estrada has an answer also to the question earlier of Congresswoman Sara. If I got you right, is that can you raise your answer if you may?
Yeah. Mr. Chair, just on the issue on the tuition increase and the other issues raised by Congresswoman Sara on the refund, we just would like to appeal, of course, to Congresswoman and to the committee for some understanding also of the private higher education and the entire private education sector. We are in the middle of a perfect storm. We are fully tuition funded. We rely on the timely payments and when we think of viability, we think of our school personnel first and foremost. Like for example, in the tuition increases, if ever there may be application for tuition increases, 70% of that goes to the school personnel, and it's all tied up to our request for assistance on behalf of our school personnel, because if there will be no more funds for us to support them in our payroll, the tendency really would be to ask for an increase. But of course, we're mindful of our enrollment also. We don't want to close our doors to the students who are also suffering from this economic downturn. So we just would like to appeal for some understanding and to resolve this in our respective academic communities, because the first priority now is to sustain our schools and not to close, because it will affect the students, it will displace them, but also it will affect our school personnel. The same principle applies in that we follow in the tuition refunds. If we still have the money, I think the schools would really want to do that, but these are all institutional funds, and we have to support and sustain particularly our school personnel. So this is part of our balancing interest. Even if we want to refund an unutilized portion of their fees, I think at this point, we have exhausted all our means just to sustain our school personnel, particularly our faculty, even when we are under suspended operations. So yun lang po, Mr. Chair. And we support the points raised by our good Chairman Popoy de Vera of the Commission on Higher Education. Salamat.
Okay.
Chair Go.
At this point, we'd like
Chair.
To...
Chair?
Just one last comment, short comment. We'll adjourn it already. Congresswoman Sara. Yeah, please.
Pasalamat, Chair. Gusto ko lang pong tanungin ang COCOPEA kung may mga schools po tayo na natulungan, halimbawa po ng DOLE, pagdating sa education support personnel, may aid po ba para dun sa mga nag-apply na schools na micro, small, medium enterprise? If ever. Kasi may mga lumalapit din po sa amin na nanghingi din po sila ng aid, na pero naubusan na po ata. Sa knowledge niyo po ba, meron pong mga nabigyan po ng ayuda?
Yeah, Mr. Chair, I'd like to respond.
Short response, yeah.
Yeah. Congresswoman Sara, as I've said earlier, we have yet to hear of a school who received the financial assistance under CAMP. I think we all applied, but again, I think most, if not all, have been denied. Even when the assistance has been transferred to the DOF, now the DOF is saying under the small business wage subsidy, the education sector and the school personnel are also not eligible for the assistance. Because previously it was under CAMP. Wala rin pong, so far, wala pa po kaming nabalitaan sa members namin. Siguro yung at most under process, but the others, they were denied outright. Salamat po. Kung matutulungan niyo po kami na magkaroon po ng separate social amelioration package. This was also raised by Secretary Liling Briones and our chairperson, Popoy de Vera, in the IATF. They support that. I think they just need to find the funds now. we also would like to reiterate that request to Congress on behalf of our school personnel. They also need your help now very urgently. Maraming salamat po.
Thank you very much. Thank you for everyone's active participation in this afternoon's discussion. It has been truly enlightening, and I think we have been well appraised of the situation, concerns, and strategies of the different stakeholders, and we have worked out the many things that we need to do. Allow me to briefly do a recap of some of the important points we have discussed earlier. If you look at the current situation as presented earlier, the higher educational institutions continue to play an active role in supporting the frontline through various means. COVID-19 has disrupted the lives of students and faculty members and many staff at the different universities and colleges. And definitely, we have seen also a lot of students who are currently stranded locally and abroad. The SUCs and the LUCs are given flexibility based on CHED's advisory with regard adjusting or ending the second semester and the grading system to be implemented. But no physical classes is allowed beyond April 30. I stated also that by Chairman Popoy, the 3.6 billion for tests was already released, and the remaining 6 billion will be probably released soon too. Most test training and assessment programs were suspended, but enrollment in online programs had increased. The realignment of TESDA scholarship funds for the social amelioration program. We have also seen a projected dropout of more than preparing ban on JO or job orders will greatly that was mentioned earlier for JOS and COS is between 7,100. Full online learning is not feasible for some SUCs. CHED proposes flexible learning schemes. Only about 20% of the SUCs are ready for online learning, but majority have limited ICT infrastructure. Limitations on facilities of SUCs in implementing the new normal protocols. We have seen also that many students will have problems. These are some of the proposed items that are presented today. There should be flexible learning to start in August, and residential face-to-face learning is possible in September. It's stimulus package for education, either by a separate bill or appeal for inclusion to the authors of the already pending stimulus package in Congress. There is a suggestion for this committee to pass a resolution to support CHED's position regarding the national budget circular. Also, the inclusion of SUCs, JOS, COS, and other income earners be included in the SAP. Collaboration with LGU for delivery of learning modules, provision of wage subsidies and financial assistance to faculty and staff in private higher educational institutions, and also the inclusion of education sector in the list of industries for the economic stimulus. These are some of the suggested items. And of course, we have seen the active participation of everybody in this meeting. And I hope that next Monday, when we start our session in Congress, we can consider filing the necessary bill that will help not only our educational institutions in the public sector, but also in the educational sector. Again, in behalf of the Committee on Higher and Technical Education, we would like to thank everybody for their participation, resource persons. We have, of course, Chairman Popoy de Vera and Secretary Sidla La Peña and the other heads of the different education organizations with participation this afternoon and this evening. And we hope that this was a very productive exercise for all of us. Again, thank you very much at mabuhay po tayong lahat. Thank you.
Thank you. Stay safe.
Mr. Chair. Thank you, Chair.
Stay safe, everyone.
Thank you, Chair. God bless everyone. Thank you.
Bye.
Okay,
God bless. Bye.
Buenas noches.
Objection to the bill at magandang gabi po sa inyo lahat.
God bless.
Yes. Eleni, thank you.
Miss Melanie.
Thank you, sir.
Well, it's Melanie and our staff who put these things together. Maraming salamat.
Miss Melanie.
Sir?
Yes. Request ko sana na maka-request ka ba ng lahat ng presentations?
Yes, sir. Actually, nag-e-email na ako.